My name is Fulton Colburn. I'm the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art, curator of collections and exhibitions. And it's my pleasure to introduce our esteemed guests, Michael Duncan and Karen Carson, to you today. A couple of words before I do so. I wanted to note that Karen has three works in the collection of the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art and one piece currently on loan as well. And two of those pieces are in exhibitions that are up on the wall right now. And you could see them in the virtual tour if you would like to by going to the museum's website at artmuseum.usu.edu. And then click on the exhibition page and then click on either one of two exhibitions, and they are Women, Surrealism, and Abstraction, which will be up at the museum through the spring of 2022. Barns, Cows, Tractors, Horses, Hay, and Farmers, which is up through May 8th. And if you click on one of those exhibition tabs, you'll be able to scroll down on the exhibition, click the exhibition itself, and then you will be able to see the virtual tour tab, and you just click that and it'll put you right into the virtual tour. So I wanted to note that these exhibitions have been made possible through the support of the Utah Division of Arts and Museums. I also wanted to thank George Wanless and Philip Brown for today's technical support. And we expect the program to go on for about an hour, the last 15 minutes of which we'd like to address questions from the audience. And you can type those questions as Michael and Karen are having their conversation into your chat function there on Zoom. I've had the pleasure of knowing both Michael and Karen for some time, Michael longer than Karen, but it's been interesting watching Michael do some of the most interesting programming I think that's available on Art from the West Coast in the 20th century. So to give you a little bit of a background on Michael, he has a BA in English from Haverford College. He got that degree in 1975. He has an MA in English from the University of Virginia, Charlottesville, and that was completed in 1977. Cinema studies, he also has a credential from cinema studies at New York University, and he went there from 77 to 79. Michael has written extensively for a number of art publications, probably the most prominent of which was as the corresponding editor for Art in America from 1993 to 2017.
Actually, to the present.
Oh, to the present? I'm sorry. I'm just looking at you.
Yeah, no, my resume is old. So.
Okay, I'll have to straighten that one out. Michael is an independent curator, as I mentioned earlier, and some of the exhibitions that I've most enjoyed, and I'm not going to try to tell you about all the exhibitions he's done because it's, I think, literally been hundreds. Picking among those, I've really enjoyed the Big G stands for Goodness, the Legacy of Sister Carita Kent's 1960s Pop. Also, L.A. Raw, Abject Expressionism in Los Angeles, 1945 to 1980. An Opening of the Field, Jess, Robert Duncan and Their Circle. And finally, a new publication that's just fresh off the, or fresh from the publisher and the printer, hasn't yet reached our shores, but it is due probably on the boat fairly soon. And the publication and exhibition are titled Another World, the Transcendental Painting Group. And that's going to open at the Crocker Art Museum. I also know that Michael has several exhibitions that he's been working on for years. And they come to fruition at different times for different reasons. And we're keeping our fingers crossed that the Adeline Kent retrospective exhibition that he's doing will open soon at Laguna Art Museum. So a little bit about Karen's background. She was born in Corvallis, Oregon, and received her BA in 1966 from the University of Oregon and her MFA from UCLA in 1971. In 1994, she was an artist in residence at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and that's where Dave Hickey taught, which is an interesting pairing. She began exhibiting in 1969 at the Athenaeum Gallery, Caltech, the Pasadena and Cirrus Gallery from 73 to 77. Had a longstanding exhibition history at the Rosman Felsen Gallery, and is now with Gavlak in Los Angeles, where she exhibited this past year in an exhibition called Karen Carson Middle Ground. That was from January 9th through March 6th of 2021. She's also scheduled to be showing in a two-person exhibition at Frieze London in October. It's a two-person show. The other artist is Gisela Colon. So that's going to be pretty interesting. Michael and Karen have known each other for a long time. Don't be surprised about their candid conversation and remarks. So with that, I'm going to leave it to you. One note, I will be trying to pull up slides as particular works are addressed during the Zoom. Okay.
All right. Ready to go.
Thank you, Bolton.
Thank you.
Yeah. I've known Karen for over 30 years and followed her work really closely. And I just wanted to start by, I have a little statement I'd like to read that summarizes my own enthusiasm for her work. In paintings, drawings, banners, and installations over the past decades, Karen Carson has changed styles with the broad strokes of a rock star, moving from abstraction to feminist iconography to spiritually charged messages. Her work is unified by the consistency of her pumped up, optically orientated vision. Whether using symbols, caricature, or illusionistic space, her art hooks viewers into an urgent engagement with the world at large. Her projects seem united by a desire to represent the flux of visual reality, manifested both in nature, earthquakes, fires, windstorms, and culture, wars, politics, spirituality. All her projects, including abstract paintings, symbolic feminist tableaus, painted globes depicting celestial struggles, commercial style banners that advertise spiritual truths, light boxes depicting forest fires, skyscapes of clashing herds of horses, and beachscapes filled with mysterious dancers in silhouette, all have manifested Carson's desire to find visual analogs for the commotion of contemporary life. Unlike so much of today's art about art, her ambitious work speaks to what we see and feel in the experience of daily life. So I'd like to just start with having asked Karen, how did you come about being the kind of artist that changes gears I think we're all familiar with artists who do one thing and they've made that painting for 45 years and they have refined that painting and it's interesting, but heaven forbid they paint a tractor. So I'm curious how you came about deciding, or whether it was just instinctual to let yourself go in so many directions.
Sounds like I've been really busy. It's sort of incredible.
You have.
But I'm old, so I've been able to do quite a bit. I was just thinking last night as I was sort of going over myself once again, thinking about who I am. The starting point for all the changes in my work is the fact that I come from a family to whom change was absolute a dire enemy. And we had a home in which change was dangerous and getting attention was also dangerous. So two of the things that I spent time all of my life overcoming is that sort of beginning. And I found as an artist an outlet for, number one, getting attention, which every kid wants, and making art from impulses, because I felt that if you had an idea, which you just came up with one morning, that you would just go to work on it. And as an artist, and I'm sure many other artists, we have lots of ideas every day. So I would just find an idea and start working on it. And usually the first parts of doing the series would be failure. And I would keep working and working. And I think that I developed a love of the process of examining the way to make a new image. And so I would just start working. And when I finally solved it, I would make several works of art. And then it wasn't boredom that made me change, but it was something that in my life had more than likely had changed. So, or something in the culture had changed. And so I really feel that if I made the same thing over and over again, I wouldn't feel like an artist. And that doesn't mean that people who do that are not artists, but I remember seeing a lecture at Santa Barbara by an artist from New York who actually spent a half an hour on nothing but red triangles. And that was the sum total of his career. And I thought, how could anyone, that's surreal to be able to do red triangles for 20 years. But anyway, change is good. And I also like the idea of surprising people with new work, because it was a way of getting attention and being in the world and people feeling that they were seeing something new from me. So it's always been a good trip, forward motion.
Well, that's always been an element for your viewers. Who never know what to expect when they go to one of your openings. There's going to be something different, something a surprise. It's really a kind of theater, theatrical experience of walking into the gallery and going, oh my God, she's done gloves, or she's done horses flying through the air. But I think the biggest surprise for everybody that's followed your career over the years was seeing the tractors. Yes. And especially in Los Angeles, where it's tractors are not part of everyday experience or everyday thought. I think it would be great if you could sort of lead us through your experience. I know it started, the idea of it started when you first started going to Montana, and an attempt to try to deal with the grand landscape of the West.
Yes. Well, when we moved to Montana for the summers, I was in love with the nature and the views and the mountains and everything, but it was not something that I felt like I wanted to paint, because everybody's done that. And it's it would be a cliche for me. So I kept looking for what was the indigenous culture of Montana and what I could find in it that would be interesting. And I found that driving around, I was always looking in the fields and seeing these big, bright colored farm machines, which seemed to animate the landscape. And they stood in for animals, and they showed the kind of masculine identity that Montana has. So one day I just did a little drawing of a tractor, and I realized that this was my new series. And I was interested in the fact that they were so sexy and they were so male and so big and so powerful that I felt that I had to bring my vantage point to these big beasts. So I started doing them, and they were probably the most fun I've ever had painting. They were just kind of wonderful and muscular and bright and shiny, and it was a thrill. And putting them up on the wall and just walking among these giant paintings was a real thrill. I had a great time.
Do you want to bring, Bolton, you want to bring up one of the images?
Yeah,
here we go.
Yeah, big red.
This one is, what kind of tractor is that?
It's a big red International Harvester.
Oh, International Harvester.
Big Red's my name, but it's an International Harvester. It's model number 435 that you can see on the side.
Right. And you were meticulous about the details of the tractors themselves, right?
Yeah.
I mean, these are accurate depictions of the beast.
Yeah, so they're edited a little bit. There'd be sprockets and bolts and things that I left out, but pretty much put the most important part of the machinery in the painting.
And I think that, you know, for me it's interesting because they seem like pop cartoon images at first, mm-hmm. and then you realize that they're actually really slow paintings where you start to kind of pull the composition apart as you look at it and make sense of it. Mm-hmm. I'm just curious whether and they also take on that anthropomorphic feeling, you know, I just am curious how that kind of struck you. Was that from the first, did they remind you of human beings or animated figures or?
Well, they do. You know, I spent a lot of years in my youth doing figure painting and figure drawing. So I think that this kind of took me into my years of training as kind of classical figure artist. And so they are animated and they are anthropomorphic, I'm sure, because you can't see the driver in the cab for one thing. So
right.
And then using the Abex painting strokes and all of the movement created by the lines I'm making makes it seem to me like it's moving. So it's moving of its own accord.
Right.
There's no one running it. And
I've heard you describe them as your boyfriends. And I think it's so funny that, you know, and it's also such it's so refreshing that they're not critiquing agriculture, or they're not really critiquing masculinity. They're just sort of a sly comment on it, right?
Yes, exactly. They are boyfriends. Well, there's a Western song out that, My baby loves my girlfriend thinks my tractors are sexy, and it's a song about how he shows off with his tractor to his girlfriend. So
right, right.
It's a real part of the regional culture up there. You can't, you know, the whole farming business is done by these machines, and they're very powerful symbols of agrarian society.
Right. Bolton, can you bring up another one, that big job?
Well, there's a Columbine. I did some other machines other than tractors. This is a combine who I actually don't know how it works, but it spews out the wheat chaff. I should ask my husband what exactly it does. Some of these things were sort of mysterious to me.
Well, this one has, I mean, it has, definitely has a different personality. And I think through the angle and those Google eyes at the wheels, he seems a little shifty I don't know. It's a complicated character, right?
Yes. Now that you said Google eyes, I'm going to be stuck on that the rest of my life. But there they are. Never noticed that. It's very funny.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
You think?
Yeah. I mean, you just kind of see them as different characters. And what's funny, too, is, you know, the way little boys play with trucks and stuff and how, you know, you wonder whether that whole anthropomorphic thing is a part of that. It's like you're playing with these toys also, mm-hmm. in a funny way.
Absolutely. You put it very well.
Oh, well.
I just look at these things now and I think of how much fun they were. Like, this is 12 feet by 8 feet, so they were quite large. And I had to use the scaffolding to work on them, and they were very, very large project for me.
And you didn't frame them, right? They're just with grommets onto the wall?
They're just actually just nailed to the wall.
Nailed to the wall.
Yeah, I thought of having them stretched on stretchers, but I really like the fact that there are such volumetric images that actually float on the wall. It gives a nice contrast between the muscles and the flatness of the wall.
Yeah. There's another one, Bolton. I'm forgetting the title. We saw him. Oh, no, we didn't see. Yeah. Yeah, we saw him. Isn't there a third, another image of the tractors?
Yeah, there's a number. Do you want to see Big Guy or Here's Texas Harvest?
That one's good. Another, yeah, I mean.
With Google eyes. This one has a nice story behind it. It went to an art fair in Houston. And so there were three of my tractor pieces hung up in Rosamund Felsen's space there. And this woman came walking down the aisle, and she was a real Texas woman with perfectly set hair and blonde hair and wonderful clothing and a confident walk. And she came in up to the booth and looked at that painting, kind of put her eyes up and down on the image and said, "Wrap it up." She bought it. Which was,
oh, that's great.
Really, just wrap it up.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, this one's like really lumbering, and it's sort of like he has an overbite, right?
Yes. Yeah, you can see his little white teeth right under the grill. That's funny.
Yeah. 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 Well, sense of humor has always been a part of your work, and it comes out every now and then. But there's a kind of, I think, theatrical audacity in what you do. Can you bring up Flowers of Fate, Bolton? This was the series you did of in 1990. Mm-hmm. And these are wild, huge pieces with mirrors and clocks and explosions and butterflies. And can you kind of lead us into your impulses in making this body of work?
Well, I was thinking one night about how women had been put into this sort of painting flowers and painting flower arrangements and doing flower arrangements. And it was a real feminine pastime. And I just decided in my head I would do the biggest flower painting I could come up with, and started working on this one. And it comes from a lot of sources. Actually, my grandfather was a Norwegian, and he made these paintings on wood that were called toll paintings. And so that influence is in there. There's tattoo imagery. There, the clocks I had been collecting for years and sort of waiting to use those in something. And so I've attached those to the picture, along with some mirror and some light. Let's see, I guess there's mirror and picture molding and acrylic paint and the clocks. Our family had 11 clocks in our house, and we were not clock collectors. They were just clocks that occurred around the house. Like, there was one in the middle of the refrigerator door. There was one in the living room. There was one in each bedroom. So I kind of lived with this Scandinavian sense of time, which meant keeping a lot of clocks going. I don't know why, because they don't like change very much, but there they were.
Well, it's this body of work is such an explosive one. I'm curious about how you violate all of the kind of sanctity of the flat picture plane that everybody was taught back in the 60s. And you use depth of field, you're using real objects mixed with abstract design, just making reliefs in itself is such a kind of iconoclastic thing to do. I think you're remarkable in your audacity. And do you feel like you were fighting against your teaching in graduate school at UCLA?
I guess I'm not quite sure what you're asking, but I like the word audacity, of course. That feels very good. I sort of like making things that are in the between, formalism and kitsch. And I like that sort of place where you realize that not only people who understand and know art and are very literate could like the painting, and people who know nothing about art can really associate with the aggression and the pictorial elements of the piece. In fact, I think that when a plumber came into my studio and went crazy for the painting, I felt like I was, straddling the right demography for these paintings, that they come out of kitsch and they come out of highly structured pictorial space and formalisms.
Right. But, I always had thought that somebody like Diebenkorn was really important to you in the beginning, and when you first started doing abstract painting. Can you bring up a block, Bolton? That one, yeah. This is earlier, of course, and more of a conventional flat surface, but you're definitely playing with space there, making these blocks go in and out of the depth of field, as and juxtaposed with that circle image going through. And this was made when you lived in New York for a period, right?
Yeah, this was made almost before I started making the clock paintings. This had to do with living in a city that is very compact and very dense, and you can walk the streets of New York and get a sense of all of these different buildings that attach to one another. And as a painter, from the very beginning, even when I was a child, I was so interested in the idea of the illusion of space and the kind of technical flatness that you get when you work on a two-dimensional surface. So I always like the idea of dealing with ambiguity of space, like where you can penetrate the surface or when the surface comes out to meet you. So the great fun of being a painter is doing that dance with the flat surface, that you go in and out and in and out. The surface becomes the surface in some places, and in other places the surface disappears. So I've always been in love with that. In fact, one of the most thrilling moments I've ever had as an artist was when I was a kid and learned to draw my first image of railroad tracks. And when you first learn perspective as a painter, of a two-dimensional painter, you get this wonderful thrill of losing the surface and moving in to the into the picture plane. So it's all my whole, I think my whole career as a painter has had to do with extrusion and intrusion, the idea of going in and out. I think that's been my joy in working on the on a two-dimensional surface. Mm.
And actually that kind of applies also to the figurative work that you've done. Mm-hmm. There's intrusion and extrusion of, you know, you've done pieces that seem really personal to you psychologically, like the feminist works, and then comments on the culture at large with the globe, say, or some of the seascape paintings and landscape paintings. Mm-hmm. So can you bring up God's Eye, Bolton? This one, yeah. So this is, you're using, this is a relief, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So can you explain that, how you do these?
Yeah, this is a picture that comes between that last one you saw that I did in New York and the flower paintings. So I did these abstract paintings for a while that I sort of lovingly refer to as hippie paintings, and because they have a lot to do with mirrors and rainbows and cliches. But this has mirrors that you see some light stripes going down in the picture, and they're strips of mirror. And part of the influence for this was going to Tijuana and seeing all this pottery that had mirrors on it. And it was also my way of making a pun about making an abstract painting be a figurative painting, because when you stood in front of it or moved around, you could see yourself in the painting,
right,
but thereby making it into a figurative painting. But you can see from this that I'm still sort of trying to plunge into the center of to the back wall of the painting, and then and allowing other parts to really come forward. And I also thought of these things as glamour paintings. I really felt that they were about being a woman and being interested in fashion and glamour and making things that were beautiful, including myself. So that's the story about that one. And God's Eye, of course, are these images that are made out of concentric weavings of fabric, of yarn, and you can buy them in tourist shops.
Right. But they are supposed to be objects for sort of contemplation and meditation.
Yes, absolutely.
Right?
Yeah, like
in traditional Indian Native American culture, I think that's what they were for.
Yeah. But,
and I'm curious, is that an application that you think of as applying to your abstract paintings or to all of your work, that they're objects for contemplation or meditation?
Yeah, I think that I really, as an artist, really want people to take time to look at my things, because I think that all the spatial ambiguities and movement that goes on, and it needs needs people to just sort of look at it. And you can look at it either in parts or you can look at it as a whole. And when you look at it as a whole, you can sort of feel your eyes and you can feel your face. And I was meditating at the time that I did this painting. And you know, there's that sort of moon on the left-hand side of the painting that flares out into space. That's kind of a place where you can rest your eyes and let the things just sort of be, as opposed to where the black dark area is. You kind of sink into it and you move with the darkness. Is that
spray paint, the white part?
Yeah, there's spray paint on these paintings. I haven't looked at this.
And where is the mirror actually? Is it in the vertical bars?
There's a white rectangle that you see in the middle of the dark area. Yeah, right there. That's a mirror. And those white stripes that go down, everything that's really white on there is a bright white like that is a mirror. So I think there's four vertical strips of mirror, which make the painting sort of, when you look at it, sort of disassemble, because you see the background in the painting. And it sort of gives you the feeling that it could break apart. I like the idea that it has that moment of fragility.
Do you sketch these out? Do you plan the composition before you start?
Yeah, I do it somewhat. I never really strictly adhere to a drawing, but I've sort of have an idea. But most of it's done as I go along, because there's so much about warping space and changing the depth of field and stuff that I have to really be there to do it. It's hard to do it in a drawing.
Right. So Bolton, can you go to a primary composition? I think it's the next one. Yeah. So this is one of your new pieces, right?
Yes. Uh-huh. That was the very first bas relief I did a year and a half ago. And it's also made with applied wood pieces, like pieces of molding and balsa wood. And it's very dimensional. And it also has this kind of vertical breaking up of space that God's Eye had. These paintings to me were so visual and so eyeball fascinating that I really have very little that I can actually say about them. It's interesting because I had been doing figurative things right up until where I started doing these. And all of a sudden I'm in the studio with Abstraction and there's no narrative to go with it. So they were built just to be powerful visual experiences. And the bas-relief stands in for, I never liked using thick paint, but I've always liked surfaces that have thick paint on them. So this bas-relief was sort of a solution to building a surface that didn't require me to use heavy and thick paint.
And the visual experience of them changes in terms of depending on where you're standing, right? As you move back and forth.
It changes a bit. The bas relief is fairly shallow, so you don't get an amazing change in the painting, but it does change it. That I've intended them mostly, even ironically, that they're bas relief to be looked at right from the middle of the painting, because I made the middle of the painting be a place you could start and then you could kind of move out to the edges and move back in. So they're full of what I consider motion.
Well, it's interesting because I know that in your vinyl textworks or the vinyl works use a lot of arrows. And I can see those arrows on either side of the central. I didn't notice this before when I looked at this painting. Do you see what I'm talking about?
Yes, I do. There's two black and red arrows.
These
paintings sort of celebrate the triangular shape. And if you look at a lot of my work over the years, it's been a shape or a symbol that I've used quite a bit. I even did paintings using arrows. So,
right.
And that's kind of like a visual pun when you go through art history and the art historian is showing you Renaissance paintings and they tell you how the arm leads into the leg and the leg leads into the drapery. And, you know,
right.
We're taught to peruse paintings by following visual clues for the movement of the eyes. So I think that these are a little bit about that.
Right. Well, that's that theatricality aspect of your work, you know, you're pointing at what we can notice and have the possibility of noticing if we pay attention. This also struck me as it's reminiscent of some Native American rug designs or mm-hmm. Was that something that occurred to you?
Yeah, I've spent some time in my life around lots of Navajo blankets, and I think that weaving does enter into this one, a warp and a woof.
Right. I want to go back to that idea that with this work, it seems to me, does have this meditative aspect to it, that these really are objects for contemplation and almost like mandalas. Mm-hmm. Or does that seem too much for you?
No, it's really, that intention is in there from the very beginning. It's back to the idea of meditating and feeling the third eye so that you close your eyes and you have this, you have the both sides of your brain and you have the center of the brain that begin to sort of register with your body. And I think that's really characterizes a lot of these, because all the bas-relief paintings have a strong visual center and then they move out on either side. And I love Hilda af Klimt, and I, you know, love spiritual paintings. So I guess you could say that these have that as a strong underpinning. I don't know that, I don't expect people to get that, but some people have gotten it. So that's good. You have, Michael.
Yeah. Well, it's just, especially during the pandemic, I've been sort of struggling with appreciating a lot of abstract painting because it all seems so not addressing anything, any issues. And I'm talking about paintings that are just blobs or dibbity-dobbities you know, there's so much of it now, especially with young artists who think they've invented abstract expressionism. So, you know, the whole kind of spiritual content of a certain type of abstraction does really interest me. I think it's what abstraction can do in a really powerful way that even a lot of figurative art can't do.
Well, it's also interesting that people will find something in an abstract painting. Like a couple writers refer to these bas-reliefs as landscape-based, and I'm having a really hard time getting that from the painting. So, but you know, whatever, that's the virtue and the vice of abstract painting is there to be interpreted, and people try so hard to find something in an abstract painting.
But
it is interesting that, you know, studio life as a painter for me has been one in which, you know, when I do figurative painting, the studio life seems very, very different. It seems so much more social. And you start making abstract paintings and all of a sudden you're sort of struck without having language for it, without having a dialogue, and you become purely a painter. You start using shape and color, and that's what you do. You sort of leave the world behind. The studio becomes a sort of sanctuary of non-language.
Wow.
I don't know what to, that's sort of an insult to a writer like you. Is I decided to leave words behind for a while. It's interesting.
Right. Yeah. Well, that seems like a good place to end without words. So
that's great. You know, here's a question from Patricia Leah Watts. Saying, I included Karen's early Burning Beds in my graduate thesis exhibition in 1992 at Cal State University Fullerton. I'm curious, knowing her work since then, Abstractions, what is her attraction to the rural now, agricultural machinery? What provoked the transition, and will she continue to focus on agriculture? Where does she stand on industrial ag and the chemical impacts on the environment? Is she concerned about the ecological issues?
I'm sorry to say, I probably haven't thought about that in terms of my own work. I think about it in my own life, of course, but I really sort of stay away from social issues with my work. As you can see, they're mostly just works of art that have to do a lot with seeing and not, and the content is not clear. So I would say that I haven't been that interested in ecological issues.
Well, it's a feature of your globes, you know.
That's true.
She did a series of painted globes, and it was a complete apocalypse. It wasn't just ecological disaster, it was every kind of disaster.
That's true.
And they were hung all over the gallery, and it was a really powerful experience. It was more like a Goya experience than an ecological comment. You know, I think Karen's work is, you know, speaking to really deep, deep issues. So
thank you. Yeah, I'd forgotten the globes. They were made about, I did a giant painting that had to do with the Los Angeles riots.
And ecological.
So
that was the best artwork made in response to the riots that I ever saw.
That's one of the problems when you do as many kinds of work as I do. You sometimes forget that a series was dedicated to certain ideas. Thank you, Michael, for bringing that up.
Sure.
So, you know, there was one slide we didn't show, and it's an early drawing called How to Draw a Gun. I'm fascinated by this drawing, and I'm going to do a screen share on it with it. Because, I mean, the same kind of question could be asked, pointing question could be asked about is there a relationship between this drawing and your view of gun control? Views on gun control. So, and it's a pretty interesting drawing on a lot of different levels. As I remember it, there was a book on drawing, and the hand, the cover was a hand doing a drawing. So it's interesting you've got so many references here to that, but what do you think about, I mean, what is your thinking? Do you like things to be more ambiguous in terms of possibly being a statement about gun control? Anyway, go ahead, Karen.
Well, this was done in, I think, 72, maybe 74. And it was before guns had such an awful impact on our culture. Although I was well aware that people in our culture love guns way too much, but to make myself seem piteously simple, it started out as these drawings started out as a visual pun, of course, how to draw a gun. So the pun was there first and the drawing came second, but looking at it now, I haven't looked at this for years. You can see that it has a much different impact with all of the killings and all of the use of guns in our culture. But in some way, I hate to feel like I'm making fun of the idea of a gun, because it feels so different to look at it now.
Well, it certainly shows how facile you are with your hand as well. So, was that part of a series, Karen?
Yeah, it was all how to draw drapes, how to draw a bath, how to draw flies, how to draw. So it was just a whole series of drawings that spoke to puns.
Okay, I don't see any more questions here. I don't know if you have any closing comments, Michael.
Well, Karen, did you want to say something about what you're going to do next?
Well, I'm going to continue with the bas reliefs, but I think that they'll be vertical rather than horizontal, and they'll have images of faces. So they're going to look like kind of ethnographic masks, but they won't be obvious. You'll have to look at the picture and the faces will come out of them. So I have a feeling that, you know, having a room full of these, these mask-like faces will really be fun. And it also has to do with having looked at people wearing masks for the last year.
Right.
The idea that the face has been covered up. And so I'd like to sort of reveal the faces coming back.
That sounds terrific. So, and also, you know, I know in your Gavlak show, you showed some of your early zipper paintings, which we haven't talked about here. There have been so many different aspects to your work, we didn't get to that. But Karen did these amazing cloth pieces that were in sections connected by zippers, and they were in geometric shapes. And the zippers would unzip and it would fold down, so you would get diagonal shapes and square shapes. And they've created a lot of stir over the years. They did back after she did them. And then there was a show a few years ago. Roseman had a show of them too, right?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And now at Gavlak, people. A new audience were kind of astounded by that. Do you want to just talk about how you came about doing those cloth pieces a bit?
Sure. Yeah, I'm actually doing a couple new ones that I've added color to, just for the fun of kind of doing something from the past. And
the color on both sides of the fabric, or different colors?
Yeah, different colors. And so. They came about as a kind of commentary about feminist art in the face of minimalism, which was such a masculine school of art, so to speak, that, you know, using lead and metal and steel and glass and all of these hard shiny surfaces, that I decided that sewing something would be my answer to feminism. I mean, my answer to the masculine part of the art world at the moment. So I got out my sewing machine and started making these things. And they also had to, in some very peculiar way, had to do with abstract expressionism, because when you zipped and unzipped these things, the pieces that fell out became strokes and, you know, parts of a composition that sort of moved and fell apart by strokes. So they were, and then plus they were fun and they were kind of silly in their own way. You know, this idea that you could go up to a wall and just zip, 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 and the thing would become a different object.
Right. No, they're really brilliant works, and I think people have enjoyed them over the years and continue to. And again, it's that there's that sense of theater involved in what they are, their essence. So.
Yeah.
Patrick Nickel has a question about what's going London, Karen.
Zipper pieces.
Ah.
Yeah.
So.
I don't know whether they'll be old ones or whether I'll make new ones. I'm not sure yet what will show, but it definitely will be zippers.
And you the Gavlak show you had in LA drew a lot of praise. And it seems like you're really being noticed and being put on the radar screen in terms of art and art history going forward. How are you feeling at this point in the game?
It scares me, quite frankly. I really don't do a lot of, I'm not very good at a lot of attention. So it's interesting that for the first time in many years, I got lots of reviews and lots of feedback on my show. And it's been really wonderful, but it's also kind of scary. I'm a shy person, and lots of attention is sometimes difficult for me. So we'll see how it goes. I'm enjoying it.
Well, anyway, I certainly want to thank you both, Karen and Michael, for taking the time out of your days to do this. And I know it's unusual for Michael too, because he's in France right now. It's 8 o'clock in the evening. So that's a big time change. So, and Karen, especially since you tend to be somebody who doesn't appear publicly and speak publicly very often, I appreciate your doing this for us today.
Pleasure.
I wanted to note for everybody that's watching that we've recorded this, and at the end of the week, it'll post on the museum's website. So thank you again for attending today. And thank you, Michael. Thank you, Karen.
You're welcome. You.
And have a good lunch or dinner or after dinner.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. See you.